Welcome to Banff Centre Talks. I'm Patti Schmidt. It was a chance encounter with an oscilloscope that changed Robin Fox's career. For a brief moment in that green glow, he caught a glimpse of the DNA of sound. Since then, the Australian artist has spent the years untangling that moment, exploring how sight and sound intermingle. Fox's captivating laser shows have been performed in dozens of countries around the world, translating electricity into adventurous displays of light and noise, all in his pursuit to uncover the structure of sound. Robin's work extends past just that one medium. He's built massive interactive public sculptures that translate movement into sound. He's worked as a composer for several renowned dance companies in Australia, and he's even composed music designed specifically for bionic hearing aids. He's both a cataloger of electronic music's history and one of the artists pushing it forward into new territory. It's my pleasure to welcome Robin Fox to the Banff Centre. Hi, Robin.
Thank you, Patti. It's a lovely introduction.
Let's start with the oscilloscope. What happened there that made you rethink sound?
Well, it's kind of odd the way it all came about. So there's a bit of a backstory, I guess. At the time that I encountered the oscilloscope, I was actually making quite a lot of harsh noise. My interest in harsh noise, I think, came up from my youth as a sort of heavy metal drummer, a failed heavy metal drummer. But I was really interested in the physicality of sound. I was studying composition at the time at La Trobe University, but I wasn't interested in technology at all. I came to technology quite late. But I was in the middle of putting on a strange kind of large-scale operatic performance, and the oscilloscope was a prop in that performance. And I just heard that you could look at sound with an oscilloscope. I just heard that you could plug like the left and right channels into the X and Y axis of an oscilloscope and look at sound, and that they used it in recording. They used them in recording studios to see if microphones were out of phase or in phase. And what I was curious about, I think, was that the noise that I was making at the time, to me subjectively, was beautiful, but to most people seemed to be really kind of obnoxious. And I was interested in that. I remember once my father came along to a noise gig that I was doing in Melbourne unannounced, and he has very classical sensibilities, a very refined man. And so when I saw him at the gig, I thought, oh, you know, this isn't going to go well. And he wasn't there after the show, and I thought, well, you know, fair enough. It was kind of a blistering noise set that I'd played. And the next day I got this phone call from him. It was the cutest thing. He said, I said, oh, so you were at the show last night. Thanks for coming. I hope you enjoyed it. And he said, I'm just wondering, you know, are you okay? And I said, well, what do you mean? I'm fine. Yeah, it was great. I thought it was a good gig. And he said, he seemed so angry. Like, I just wanted to know if there was something, you know, did something happen in your childhood? You know, he's kind of getting all paternal about it, probably feeling responsible. And that's, you know, and it occurred to me to say to him at that point, no, what I'm making to me is beautiful. So the way that relates to the oscilloscope is that I wanted to see what this noise looked like. And so I plugged it into the left and right channel of the oscilloscope, and most of what I saw was relatively uninteresting. It was kind of a mess and, you know, wasn't very exciting. And then just by chance, there was this split second where the sound and the image seemed to come together in an incredible way. And so it locked in, and it just locked, and I saw it, and immediately I just had, I guess, what I've come to call a moment of mechanical synesthesia, where I sort of saw the sound and I saw the image. I heard the sound and saw the image, and those two things were exactly the same thing. And so I think we're going to talk a bit more about synesthesia later, but the most common form of synesthesia is a sound to color relationship. And what was interesting about the oscilloscope is that it's only green. So there was no relationship between sound and color in this moment. It was actually sound and geometry and the shape of sound.
What was the shape?
Well, the shape was varied, so it moved with the sound, but the shape reflected the sound. And what was interesting was that it was a rectified sound, which means that the sound wave had lots of corners in it, so it was quite a noisy sound. But that what happened is when you look at a rectified sound, it that creates flash points where the sound turns the corner, so you actually see the geometry of the sound a lot more clearly. And I think that's so I started looking into that anyway. I took that tiny slice and analyzed why that particular moment was beautiful and worked and why all the other stuff was sort of messy and not that interesting. And it turned out that, you know, if you visualize a harmonic spectrum, for example, or sort of a pure tone, something more like a flute or even the human voice, that you don't get an interesting visual colorate, not from an oscilloscope in any case. So it turned out that this form of visualization totally suited my noise aesthetic, in the sense that the more distorted and harsh cut sort of music that I was making at that time tend to visualize really well geometrically. But then as I started to unpack that whole idea, it occurred to me, and this isn't news at all, but it occurred to me that you know, if you take time out of a sine wave, you draw a circle, right? So the oscilloscope doesn't do things in a linear way. You can put it into a polar mode where the information goes round and round in circles. So if I play a sine wave into an oscilloscope and put it slightly out of phase, I can draw a circle. And if you think about a sine wave visually, that smooth, curvy line, if you just take time out of that, it does just turn on itself and it makes a circle. And a square wave, if you take time out, makes a square, and a triangle makes a triangle. And so it occurred to me that basically sound is just a sort of a continuous stream of geometric information, and I was sort of fascinated by that. And I was also fascinated by the connection between sound and image, because my mother had synesthesia, so from a very early age I had. Synesthesia was just always in my life as a bizarre thing that would happen on birthdays. You know?
I mean, maybe you should sort of unpack synesthesia a little bit for people to understand.
Well, yeah, I mean, I think it sort of came back into the scientific consciousness only late in the 20th century, really. It was something that was looked into in the early part of the 19th century and then sort of dropped. There was no sort of rational explanation for it. There was no consistency in people's experience of it. But for those who don't know what it is, it's basically a cross-modal association. So it's a neurological phenomena whereby two aspects of your sense perception commingle. And the most, as I said, the most common version of that is sound to color correspondence. But there are as many combinations as there are combinations of senses. So some people have an amazing ability to see smells in geometric form. There was one great story in one of the books I read about a guy who only knew that the chicken that he was cooking was ready when the spikes came off the column that he could see in his mind. So he was smelling the chicken, and if it was too spiky, it wasn't ready. And then when it smoothed out, he knew it was good.
So you had this moment of mechanical synesthesia with the oscilloscope, and
So I call it mechanical synesthesia because as far as I'm aware, I don't experience synesthesia as a neurological phenomenon. And in the arts, it's interesting because it's often romanticized as a gift, you know. Mm-hmm. And creative people, there's a graph that shows that, you know, creative people are more inclined to synesthesia than other humans. But I think it's about 1 in 10.
And what was your mother's experience of it?
Well, she had a correlation between it was color, pitch, and number. So every number had a color, and every color had a note. So it was sound, color, number.
Okay.
So, you know, on my 13th birthday, it was kind of, you know, beige and, you know, B flat. You know? So, yeah, that's why it was always interesting to me.
Yeah.
You know, I always tell the story that I couldn't burp or fart at the dinner table without her telling me that was, you know, you could always verify the pitch, but she'd always tell you it was a color as well, which I found it a little disturbing.
She was in the arts though too, right?
Yeah, she was a composer. She was an opera singer when she was younger, and then she started composing music in the late 70s. She studied at La Trobe University, which is where I went on to study much later. I always thought she was a freak when I was growing up, but, you know, I ended up sort of following in her footsteps quite literally. It's odd. Like when I was at high school, she made electroacoustic music, and she was working on PDP-11 computers in the early 80s and making electroacoustic works kind of in the Trevor Wishart vein of merging electronic sounds with real world sounds. So she would turn her voice into a bird, for example, in a setting of certain poetry. Mm. And she was also very interested in atonal music. She wrote a lot of atonal, contemporary classical music, I guess you'd call it. And she sang a lot of that as well. So she sort of morphed in the 70s, the mid to late 70s. She went from singing quite standard opera into singing Schoenberg's Pierrot Lumière, Webern, and all these very challenging sort of atonal works. And when I spoke to her about her synesthesia later in life, it was she said that was a great benefit. You know, singing atonal works where you don't often have a you know, a musical frame of reference to hang the next pitch on. I mean, I used to sing in a choir where we sang atonal works, and the funniest way to keep pitch was, so you'd have an entry, and you would have no kind of musical thing, so you'd have to actually hit a tuning fork. You'd hit a tuning fork on your knee and then stick it on your head, and that was the only way you'd get the pitch like directly into the ear, and then you'd know where to enter. So it's not, I mean, atonal music isn't intuitive. So, you know, her synesthesia certainly, and her perfect pitch helped her to maintain kind of a through line. So yeah, she was a creative person. She often had the house mic'd up. You know, she'd mic up the wooden beams in the house. She'd be throwing things into bowls of water, you know, recording everything and doing sort of crazy stuff. And I'd just sort of, you know, bypass that and go and listen to heavy metal in my caravan and play the drums, you know, and pretend it wasn't happening.
It was not a total stretch that you would end up in brutal noise music and that kind of thing at all.
No, it wasn't a total stretch at all. And in fact, when it came time I studied law and literature out of high school. Like I didn't go straight into a music degree, but that wasn't the right fit for me. And after a few years, I went back and played in bands again and reconnected with drumming. And it was at that point that she convinced me to go to the university that I ended up going to, which sort of shaped the rest of my career. Yeah.
So how do you go from the oscilloscope to the mechanical synesthesia of laser art?
Well, the connection is actually really logical, and it was one that was made, you know, in the 60s, sort of at the birth of laser art generally. So I didn't know this at the time that I was discovering it, but when people were making laser shows in the 60s, they would actually prototype all their shows on oscilloscopes, because the lasers of old were kind of these big, you know, argon water-cooled things that would take an enormous amount of power to fire up and to use. So they would actually make their shows on oscilloscopes and then sort of know what the laser would do and then translate the show onto the laser. So the, you know, there was already that pathway was kind of already laid, but it, for me, that wasn't what I discovered. So what I was doing was making films for the oscilloscope. So I would build patches in software, design synths that would be, you know, that were perfect for creating visuals, because they were, you know, simple sine wave synths or waveform synths. And so I was generating that kind of material, and then I was performing that live. I released it on DVD, I think, in the early 2000s. But I'd be at concerts where I'd have the oscilloscope on the table and a camera, quite a bad sort of handy cam, that would then sort of go up to a projector, and there was a huge resolution loss across that. So I'd see this beautiful little image on my oscilloscope screen, and then I'd turn around and there'd be sort of a smear across the projector, and it was just terrible. So I got a bit frustrated with that, and I was actually doing a noise improv concert with a drummer in Melbourne in a club that I'd never been to before. And I'd never been to raves. I missed the whole rave thing. I still haven't been to one. Someone told me that one of the clubs here at Convergence was a rave, but I don't believe them. But I'd never really been to a rave, so I hadn't seen lasers in that context. I'd actually never seen a laser show in my life. But I walked into this little club, and there was a tiny, really piss-weak green laser just shooting unicorns and smiley faces, and it was kind of awful, but at the same time I looked at it and thought, well, that's really similar. Like I made the correlation between the oscilloscope and that, and I thought, well, I could make this three-dimensional. I could just turn it on the audience, and, you know, instead of looking at a screen, they could be kind of standing inside the sound. And I was really excited by that idea that, you know, an oscilloscope is a cathode ray tube, like an old television. So essentially there's a single beam of light just shooting in a vacuum, and it's scanning across a phosphorus screen. And so I liked the idea that with a laser shooting back into the audience, you could sort of get a person and put them in that, you know, in that cathode ray tube. And I loved the idea of the three-dimensionality of that, and bringing architecture into the equation. And so I tried to get an audio-controlled laser, so one that I could use like an oscilloscope. And of course, the only audio-controlled lasers you could find were beat-synced lasers that made unicorns and smiley faces. And so I was like, I don't want that. And finally, I found a laser guy who would build me one where I could just send signal directly from my sound card to the small motors that flip the mirrors that deflect the laser light. Mm-hmm. And then I essentially had an oscilloscope, but with a laser. And so that's how that system works.
I mean, I think it's probably time to maybe take a look at the explanation of how the sound and the light work together. We have a little video presentation here.
So this is what I call my Fox box. When I press a button in my system, you see and you hear the same electrical signal at the same time. It's basically like a really lo-fi function generator, so it's a really raw analog synthesizer, which is driven by images, so driven by the XY plot of the image that I send to the laser projector. It's basically an emergency stop switch for my laser projectors, which means that at any given time I can kill them. But that's not what makes it interesting. What makes it interesting is that the electrical signal that's being sent to the laser projectors is also sent out of these three audio outputs. So basically the same electrical signal that comes out to the lasers is also going straight to a mixing desk. And that's what creates the audio-visual correspondence between the sound and the light. I call it mechanical synesthesia.
So you put the lasers on stage and you create a stage show. It's your performance medium is the laser show.
Yeah.
What are some of the challenges of mounting lasers in a performance medium?
There are two main ones. I mean, the first one is expense. Lasers are expensive. Mm. The second one is, occupational health and safety. So, or basically audience safety. So, I've seen a lot of, since I started working with lasers, I guess I've seen a lot of pretty unsafe behavior. But it was a learning curve that I had to go through myself, the safety side of things. When I first started working with lasers, I had a one-car garage as my studio. And so the first laser I got that wasn't really powerful, but it was powerful enough, used to sit only a few meters away from me, and I would work with it shooting past me onto the wall, and I would create the thing that I thought was interesting, and then I'd turn the volume up so it would get bigger, and I'd swivel a little chair around, hit a little cheap smoke machine, and then just sit there a couple of meters away from the laser while it sort of did its thing. And I thought, yeah, that's cool. And then didn't realize I was probably gradually sort of shearing years off my sight. But, I figure I've done that with noise over the years, so eventually it'll be a kind of Helen Keller situation. I'll gradually become deaf and blind and write my memoirs by tape or something. I don't know. But, basically occupational health and safety is probably the biggest consideration, or audience safety.
Mm. What's the dangers?
Well, just the ocular hazard, so the danger to your eyes. So, I mean, laser beams are incredibly focused light beams, and they actually carry sort of radiation. So if a very tightly focused beam hits you directly in the retina, then you can just, you can go blind. Mm. If it's done really perfectly, you can go blind.
You're certified though, like you have a...
No, the accreditation system around laser displays is incredibly fluid and not as formalized as it probably should be.
Okay.
But I could get an accreditation as a laser safety officer, but it's not something that's required. And the requirements are so different from place to place when you're on tour that it actually makes much more sense just to employ a local person in the place that you are to be that person if the accreditation's required. Because I could get something in Australia, but I don't need to. And the thing that I could get in Australia wouldn't actually allow me to work as a laser safety officer globally. So
what about other ideas around staging on laser shows? I've seen that it configured in many different ways. Like they're the star on the floor of the stage, they're coming from somewhere else, it depends on the venue, I guess.
Yeah, it really does depend on the venue, so it's very site-specific work, I think. And a lot depends on how the smoke works in a venue, strangely, because with the sort of power that I'm working with, if there's no smoke, you can't see the beams.
Yeah.
Like, you need something in the air to articulate the light. So smoke becomes as much part of the show as anything else. But the way that I've just... I spent a few years performing on stage with the lasers going out into the audience, and I decided, not so long ago actually, only when I started working with the new configuration, the RGB configuration, rather than my single green point, I realized that performatively it was so much better for me to be in the audience watching the show with the audience. I got a lot of criticism from... I got a really short attention span, and I've got a lot of criticism from friends in the past that when I'm performing the laser show from stage, that I just skim over things, and people were sort of like, oh, that's really... oh, there it goes, it's gone, and that's really nice, but that's gone. And because I wasn't really... I was on stage and not really experiencing the show. And there's a lot of improvisation in what I do. There always is. There's a lot of contingency and things that I don't know. There's always an element of a performance for me where I don't know what's going to happen, which I enjoy. That just keeps me alive.
you're sort of touching on this now, but the sort of human part of performance with lasers, like how much of you emotionally or conceptually goes into the way you compose a program?
That's a good question. I mean, I don't really think about that very much. I guess I just make the work and I assume that part of me gets in there. I mean, you know, it kind of, it's chaotic and loud and disorganized, which is sort of like my personality a little bit. So I guess that's part of it. But whenever I'm making anything, I've never really thought too much about that side of things, about the emotional, about putting part of yourself into your work. I think that happens. It just happens as part of the making process, and it's. I leave that up to other people to experience. I've never tried to have a message in anything that I do. I never try and. I'm not sure what it is that I'm trying to communicate, I guess, is what I'm saying. Like, I don't know what I'm trying to say to people with this show, but the reaction to it is completely idiosyncratic, you know, person to person. I had one guy, it was actually in Vancouver, at the Vancouver New Music Festival. A guy came up afterwards and said he hadn't felt the way he did during my show since he'd been under fire in Vietnam. And I was like, well, I don't know. I don't know if that's a good or a bad thing. I didn't know whether to apologize or to say, wow, that's incredible. But it just indicated to me that everybody takes something different from this experience. And I also like the idea that it is, this mechanical synesthesia is just about that. It's an experience. So you go and you experience it. And if you walk away from it, you know, feeling like something more is possible than when you walked into the room, then that's, you know, that's a great outcome for me. But in terms of communicating a story or expressing something,
maybe you're a composer of experiences that have different effects.
Yeah, I think so. Yeah.
And you have to think about that too, like for a 40-minute show or
yes.
eliciting some sort of a response or guessing at what's going to be zowie or not.
Yeah, I think it's. I think for me that becomes, and this is interesting working with Uwe actually, his collaboration. He's very, we talk a lot about the flow of energy over time, and that the way to make a successful 40 minutes to an hour is to understand that energy flow, and that's very important. I mean, the laser shows that I perform are quite short, and they're quite short because they're quite intense. And so they're, you know, I don't actually want to play for an hour, because actually sitting in that environment for an hour is, I don't think it's pleasant, you know. Like, it gets too much. It's a bit of an overload, if you like.
You haven't seen the people who are just sitting there afterwards forever screaming for more, I guess. Has your mother, for example, since experienced the laser shows, and does she have any feedback on that from a synesthetic person's point of view?
No, unfortunately, she passed away before she could see one. She experienced the oscilloscope work, and she was quite interested in that. But I think the only time she saw the lasers was my stepfather built some of the hardware for me. So he used to run the computer music department at the university where I studied. So that was another aspect of my life that was, you know, connected always to music and technology. Mm-hmm. But he built the preamps that allowed me to send the sound straight from my sound card to the laser. So we had this funny sort of double story house with a big backyard. We didn't have a smoke machine, and I really wanted to test it. So it was my mother's idea to start a big fire in the middle of the backyard. And we actually shot the laser out of the second story window. And I sort of created some simple kind of liturgy patterns. And she was just in the garden kind of throwing dry leaves onto this thing and creating this huge kind of smoke stack. So that was awesome. That was a fun time. So she got to see that. She got to experience that. Yeah.
And knew the work. And in a way, electricity is the ultimate source of everything that you've done in sound and visual work.
Yes.
And it seems like there's little stories of like the family background. The family business seems to have been music and something to do with electronics.
Yeah, that's true.
Do you remember your first encounter with electricity as a source of creativity? Or maybe even as a listener, or where it caught your attention?
Well, I think it was... Yeah, it was always there. I mean, I'm not old enough to remember a time before electricity, thankfully, but it was always there. So I guess when I was a kid playing records on an old gramophone was one thing, and then obviously the cassette decks. And my stepfather was always into telling me how things worked, so I didn't retain a lot of that information, but I sort of, like at the time, I used to get into trouble. Okay, one memory from my childhood was I was obsessed with taking apart televisions, which is a completely dangerous thing to do. And in the 70s, there was no parenting, right? So you were just left alone all the time. So, you know, my parents would go out or something, and I would just take apart the TV. And it's got this massive deadly capacitor in it, you know, that could kill you. And so I used to get into a lot of trouble. And I was always in trouble for being able to dismantle things, but never remembering how to put them back together, which is, you know. And but we always had the latest technology. So I remember I had a video recorder before that was a thing. So I could tape things off the television before anyone really knew that was possible at school. So we had this massive old pneumatic video player that had a huge crank handle on it, and this big thing would eject, and the tapes were like this big, huge things. But I could still like tape the young ones and like watch it later. And the kids at school just didn't believe me. I'd tell them, and it's just, no, didn't happen. Then, you know, the first samplers were always in my house, like the DX7 came back. I remember when the first sampler came into my house, I was obsessed with the car crash sound, and I just kind of made pieces out of the car crash sound when I was a kid. Yeah, so there was all, you know, all of those associations. And but then, like I said, I didn't really, there was kind of a hiatus, and I would always drum, I would always play music, and I played lots of different instruments, and I loved that, but I didn't really sort of come around to pursuing, you know, music or sound as a life choice until my 20s, my early 20s.
And what was that switch?
So what happened was, you know, I had kids in my teens, right, which is an odd thing, but it meant that when I was 16, I sort of had this moment of realization where I thought, okay, I have this child that I have to take care of for the rest of my life. So I went from, I had quite a problematic teenage period, hence breeding and, you know, that kind of stuff. It's not normal. And but I guess the birth of my daughter really, really turned me around in one respect. And I decided to apply myself to school, realized that I was actually quite good at it, which was a shock to me because I'd always considered myself relatively stupid. And so that was kind of a surprise. And I did a whole sort of, you know, Dead Poet Society thing, and then ended up, you know, topping the school, and went to law school and did all that kind of stuff, and got sort of sidetracked doing that. And that was interesting. So I studied law and literature for about 3 years. And then it was when the relationship with the mother of my daughter, which was completely bizarre because we were teenagers. So, you know, think of your romantic interest when you were 15 years old. It's not the person you want to be with now, probably. So it took us about 5 years to work out that wasn't going to work. And then, so it was in the breakdown of that situation that I don't know how much I should say, really. There's a lot of illegality. On the basis of my law marks, I took out a bank loan, and I think I bought a drum kit and a kilo of hash, basically, kind of, you know, and had a second youth, right? Because I'd skipped a bit of youth there, because, you know, from 16 until I was 20 or so, I'd had to be quite responsible. So I'd do all my schoolwork, and then I'd get the last, and then I'd go from school to look after my daughter, and then I would get the last bus back home, and I'd study overnight and go to school. And I was really quite vigilant and dedicated for that period, and it was kind of an interesting period, but a very kind of sober and adult one for someone who was sort of 16 to 20 years old. So then I had a second youth and bought the drum kit and started playing in bands again and doing all that stuff. And it was my mother who cottoned on to the fact that I wasn't a brilliant drummer, because I was going to go to like a conservatorium and study jazz. You know, I was had my jazz phase, and she just went, no, I really don't think you're good enough to do that. And, you know, your tendency is more, a little more sort of off center. So she sort of recognized that I had a tendency to want to play things that weren't normal. And so she was teaching at La Trobe University at the time, which was a very experimental school. And she said, why don't you just come and try this out? Just come and enroll, do a year. Hmm. And it was within a week I realized that it was the perfect place. It just, yeah, the first week of lectures, I thought, this is home.
And you've never been a lawyer?
I've never been a lawyer. I read my contracts, but I've never been a lawyer. Yeah.
You've said that invention and experimentation is vital to electronic music.
Did I say that?
Someone told me you did.
Okay. Well, it might be vital to my experience of it.
But I also
think that it. I guess for me, the history of electronic music is really the history of invention. I guess when you look at turning points in electronic music, they are sort of turning points in technological innovation. Mm-hmm. So I guess those two things go hand in hand. Yeah.
Are you still inventing stuff yourself? Are you still pushing?
Well, I mean, you saw in that little video that I called the Fox Box as a joke, my little my little invention, if you want to call it that. But it's the funny thing about my inventions or innovations is that they're actually completely backward steps in technology, which I also find interesting because, you know, some people when they see a laser show, they ask me afterwards, how do you keep it in sync? How is it so tightly synced? And I said, well, because there is no sync, because it's the same thing. And it's almost like I've just taken the simplest approach. It's like you strip back any complexity, it's just voltage. It's a voltage here and it's a voltage here. And even when I met the guy who writes Pangolin, the software that I use for laser displays now, but before using Pangolin, I just sent sound out of my sound card, like my original system. And we took it to New York and there was a big sort of problem because my laser wasn't certified. So they had to fly this laser ninja in to reconfigure everything and make a certified laser work for this dance performance in New York. And you know, he's the guy who writes Pangolin, so he's Mr. Laser. And so he looked at my system and he looked at what I was doing. He said, what are you doing? And I said, I'm just like sending the voltage straight to the thing. And he's sort of scratching his head. It's amazing, it's great. Like the sync is so tight. It's like, oh, so yeah, it's just. But it's almost like the most retarded thing you could do. And so someone who, like him, who's quite an intelligent man, who's, you know, developing all this amazing technology, sort of skipped that step in a way. It's like, you can't do that with his software. And I was like, well, so there's a simplicity about it that I think is important as well.
How do you keep learning yourself? And how important is other artists' work to your own process?
Well, I think I was going to call it a philosophy. It's not really a philosophy. It's more of a tendency. But at least once a year, I like to do something that I'm completely unqualified for, because it sort of it makes it keeps life interesting. But it also it pushes you into learning things that you may not have in other situations. So projects like the Giant Theremin and you know, the Bionic Ear project, all of these things. These are things that sort of come up, and I know I'm not really qualified to do that thing, but I sort of think, well, I'm gonna do that, and I'm gonna work it out and learn about it.
Let's talk about those two projects a bit. The attraction to the Giant Theremin, the public theremin.
Well, the Giant Theremin was kind of funny because it wasn't really my idea. So I got a call from the city of Melbourne one day. I was having my coffee, and they rang up and said, "Would you like to build a Giant Theremin?" I said, "Well, who wouldn't? Awesome! Yeah, that sounds like a great idea." And so I started looking into it, and they had a few requirements. They wanted it to be playable by a lot of people, so a polyphonic instrument and all this kind of stuff. And I sort of looked into it. I rang my stepfather straight away. He's my go-to. Like, is it possible? Can we build like a massive theremin? And he said, you'll microwave people. You can't kind of do that. You can't, like, you can't build a huge circuit where someone becomes the capacitor of a circuit, like on that scale. It's just not safe. And also it'd be monophonic. And so I decided to pitch to them that I could do it, but it wouldn't strictly be a theremin, that it would track, you know, groups of people with a camera on the top of this huge instrument. And I had no idea how to do that. So I was pitching it, saying, and I even said in the pitch, I don't know if I can do this, but this seems to be the way to do it, so why don't we? And they sort of bought that. So then I had to build it. And so then, you know, it took a year or so for me to build up the system. And then I designed the object itself. And I'd never made a public sculpture before. So there were all these, I'm having meetings with engineers and public planners and just experienced a level of bureaucracy that I've never experienced before, which was kind of interesting. And then also strange considerations like, you know, climbability. Obviously, they don't want it to be climbable, right? So I designed this thing that looks a bit like something, you know, if an episode of the Jetsons was set in ancient Egypt, you know, this is what their houses would have looked like. So it was kind of like a pyramid in the end, because you can't climb a pyramid very easily. And then it's got a huge silver antenna that's 7 meters tall. So it looks, so it's kind of like a weird, but it's all rusted steel. So it looks kind of, yeah, I kind of like the design of it. It was quite odd. But you know, and there were all these conversations around, well, what are we going to do about this pole? People are going to climb the pole. And of course, so the engineers just said, we'll Vaseline the pole. We'll just grease it. I'm like, really? And so, yeah. And then they said in the meeting, have you ever tried to climb a greasy pole? I said, no. I guess I haven't. So there, you know, all of those sorts of things. It was a real learning curve. And the funniest thing was that we put it in public. We didn't grease the pole. That turned out to be surplus to requirements. But of course, there's so much kind of Red Bull and youthful exuberance around that they, you know, someone just ran up it the first night and climbed all the way to the top and like put their handprint right on the camera. So it was, and you know, but interesting things happened from that. So putting that was my first experience of putting an artwork in public and having people just kind of approach it and interact with it. And there was something deeply satisfying about that. There's something about the laser performances which feels a little bit like I'm assaulting people in some way, you know, like it's quite an intense experience and I feel like it's something that I'm doing to other people, whereas this was something that I just put there and, you know, you could kind of approach it or not. And strange things happened, like the BMX community got into it and they would do jumps off the pyramid structure and like make musical loops while they were doing jumps and they'd get into these, you know. So I loved that, and people would go down and do Tai Chi with it and, you know, interact with it in ways that I never could have.
Is it taken down?
No, they just put it back up. So I think it's back up now in Melbourne. And then, there's always a call for it to be sort of put up in country towns in Australia. So, yeah, it's a thing. It gets around from time to time.
And the bionic hearing aid?
Well, that was interesting because when I was doing my oscilloscope work years ago, there was an amazing guy, Hamish Innes Brown, who's a scientist, who was a fan. He was into synesthesia. He'd written a lot about synesthesia, and he used to come to my gigs all the time. And we were just chatting after one of these shows. He's a really interesting guy. I love talking to scientists because they know stuff. Like, to me, electricity is still magic. I don't know how it works. So I love talking to people who know how things work. And so I was talking to him, and he said he just got a job with the Bionic Ear Institute, particularly with the pitch perception project, because the interesting thing about the bionic ear is that it's designed for speech recognition. So it's kind of designed so that the most information that gets through is kind of in speech bands and stuff, and the ability to perceive pitch changes with the bionic ear was still, you know, in development and in a little bit more in its infancy. So what was interesting was we started to discuss this idea that the engineering had kind of not hit a dead end, but it was, you know, they'd engineered it to the point where there were a certain number of electrodes in the cochlear implant and they were having trouble getting more electrodes in there, so that the electrodes are equal resolution, right? So you've got about 3,000 hairs on your basilar membrane in your ear which allow you to detect pitch, and the cochlear implant feeds in 24. So if you think about that as a resolution drop, it's quite dramatic. But we started chatting about it, and I said, well, why don't you actually write music that just addresses those 24 points, you know? Start, like, rather than think about it from an engineering point of view with the hardware in the cochlear implant, think about it as a musical problem and write new music for, you know, directly for the hardware. And so that turned into a residency at that conversation at the Bionic Ear Institute. Again, so sort of from a very simplistic sort of answer to a question. And it was really fascinating project, and the music that came out of it was quite interesting as well. That because you ended up sort of, so there are 24 electrodes in the cochlear implant, and each one of them corresponds to a frequency band in a filter. So basically, there's a little microphone. The bio hardware is amazing. So there's a tiny thing they thread into the ear surgically, and then there's a piece of steel in your head, and you sort of clip this other thing onto it that snap locks to the head, which is kind of a sinister thing to see. And then there's a little microphone there, and so sound's coming into this thing, and it sort of analyzes the sound, and there are 24 frequency bands that so points in a filter. So it divides the sound up into 24 streams and then sends that information to these 24 electrodes. And those 24 electrodes basically fire little electrical pulses, you know, straight into the brain. So from an electronic music composer's point of view, this is amazing. You know, you're actually sending electrical impulses directly to the brain. And we used to have conversations about this at university that used to crack me up. So we'd say, okay, what happens when we can finally just take an audio out from your, like plug an audio out from your brain into the desk and you get to think your music, right? And then we all thought, well, now we'll know who thinks in MIDI, right? And who thinks in real sound, you know? Mm-hmm. And so this was sort of approaching that idea, is that you could compose music that goes directly into the mind of the listener. But the interesting thing was, say one of these filters is 200 hertz, I'd say to the scientist, okay, so if I play 200 hertz, will the person wearing a cochlear implant hear 200 hertz? And the answer was kind of, you know, there's like this quantum moment between, so even
because
though,
it has no, there's no perceptive,
because it has to jump into I mean, the way your brain works is so, it's kind of bizarre. I mean, it's receiving these electrical signals, and we know what happens when things are functioning normally, but we don't really know what happens if you just shoot one electrode across. And all they have is very subjective experiments where people can kind of go, yes, I can hear that, no, I can't, but they're not sure.
You didn't have like live subjects with
cochlear implants. Yeah. And so we ended up producing a concert. I commissioned some other composers to make works as well, very different. So I made all electronic works, but other people made instrumental works, did, you know, mixed media works, okay, all kinds of things. And we had concerts, it was two concerts, maybe 500 people in each, about half cochlear implant wearers, half not. And the best thing was that they did surveys straight after the concert. I've never had such great audience feedback, you know. Like, normally people, A, won't tell you what they actually thought of your show, or B, you never get to find out. So it was really interesting to actually read through these very frank assessments, you know. And luckily for me, the audience was divided. So 50% loved it and 50% thought it was absolutely dreadful. And
was, I thought, it well, that's good. Was it noise you were sending in?
No, because noise wouldn't really do anything. The first thing that I did was build a synthesizer in Max, which only addressed those 24 frequencies. So I just built like a sequencer, and I made sort of some melodic figures and some rhythmic figures. And what happens in the end is that you really just start thinking about the sound that you're making as existing on that lattice of 24 points. And so you realize, okay, well, there's an intensity thing. I can send signal to all 24 electrodes, or I can send them to one electrode. So that's one sort of parameter or anything in between. And then you can pulse them in different rhythmic configurations. And so basically it was like going right back to the basics of music generally, you know, and then trying to build interesting pieces from there. It was a really fascinating project. I'd love to pursue that further.
I guess the MESS project in Melbourne also maybe counts as a new thing outside of your comfort zone, but now you're kind of stuck with it.
Yes, absolutely. No, that's that's the thing that I'm doing this year that is I'm absolutely not qualified for.
What does MESS stand for?
Melbourne Electronic Sound Studio. And it's a public access collection of, you know, antique electronic musical instruments. But my aim is, and my partner Byron Scullin, who I've started the organisation with, the aim is for it to grow into kind of a centre for electronic music generally. But in its initial manifestation, it's a huge collection of incredible instruments, like a museum grade collection of instruments. But it's a very anti-museum ethos. So our idea is that even though something might be priceless or unique, there's no point looking at synthesizers. Like, I don't like this museum thing where you walk in and you'll look at a synthesizer. It's kind of pointless. I mean, it's interesting maybe from a design point of view, but you want to hear that machine and you want to interact with it. And interestingly, with a lot of the old electronics, you should interact with it. You should switch it on regularly. It's like a car. You've got to turn it on. You've got to turn it over. You've got to warm it up. One technician actually said, if you've got a collection of old machines, just turn one on and walk off for the day, and just leave it on for the day. Let its circuits get warm. So we're opening that next week, actually. So
big building, how many pieces?
It's not a huge building. It's a long underground, sort of semi-underground space. It used to be an old glassblower's workshop. We're starting it really as an incubation because we wanted to do it independently. We didn't, you know, you have these conversations with government, they want to upscale something too quickly and, you know, let's do this and let's do that. And I was like, no, let's just start this and see if people are interested, see if we can get a membership base, see if it's going to work as an idea. So the space is relatively modest. The collection is amazing. We can't house all of it in the space that we have. So we'll curate it in seasons, which also makes it worthwhile getting a yearly membership because when you come back.
The Bukla Autumn.
Yeah, the Bukla Autumn. Yeah. The Surge Summer, all those things, yeah. Nice, I'll just taking a mental note of that, good.
So non-precious approach, people come in, make stuff, record stuff.
Like. Yeah, I mean, it's certainly non-precious, yeah. It's certainly regulated. We have some nice rituals. Well, when you come in, you've got to wash your hands, you've got to take the jewellery off. You know, because the musicians who've given us access to their collections, there are two in particular who have enormous collections. And even though the idea for me came partly from my collection, which I inherited of amazing synthesizers that would sit fallow while I was on tour and no one was using them, and I liked the idea that they should be used, but my collection isn't enough on its own to be of great interest. But so these collectors who've given us access to their instruments, you know, obviously want them returned in the condition that they were they arrived in. So yeah, we have some nice little rituals around using them, but nothing too stringent.
Last question. Can you tell me about Laser Chicken?
Laser Chicken? Well, that's an idea that's in its infancy. I was actually thinking about what I was going to call that piece today. But there's a festival in Tasmania called Dark Mofo, which happens in the deep winter in Tasmania. And one of the things they do is kind of a large Bacchanalian feast. And there's lots of, you know, it's very sort of, you know, Viking or something. There's lots of roasting meats everywhere and kind of, you know, it's lots of fire and light and stuff. And, you know, they often ask me if I've got any ideas for installations or things I might do there. And I've done a few things there. And I just thought that one thing I might like to do is hang a big chicken in the middle of the room and just shoot it from either side with a laser and not a live chicken and cook it and just sort of see if I can burn a hole through the chicken. I don't know, I didn't know you were going to ask about that. It's kind of a throwaway idea, but it could turn into something.
I think it could turn into something.
I'm thinking of just calling it roast.
That's the end of this Banff Centre talk. I've been speaking to Australian electronic sound artist Robin Fox. And remember, you can watch more talks or download podcast versions on the Banff Centre website, banffcentre.ca. I'm Patti Schmidt. Thanks for watching. Thanks for listening.